This is episode 114 of the Reading Cove Book Club's podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining an online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com to learn more about our group. For May 2020, we're discussing The Seven Sisters by Lucinda Riley. So hi, I'm Millenia in Florida.
And I'm Roberta in Georgia.
And we are two members of the Reading Cove Book Club. And today we're here to discuss our group's 234th pick, The Seven Sisters by Lucinda Riley. And it was chosen by yours truly, me. So we are still discussing it online with the group. We've been having our online discussion for the past week. The overall grade is a B. Great
yes.
story. So this was a good one for us.
I liked it. I liked it a lot. Yeah.
I have enjoyed a couple of her other books more because I've read a few of her Lucinda Riley's other books.
Oh,
but
really?
Yeah, but yeah, I enjoyed it too. I gave it a B minus.
Yeah, I think I gave it just a regular B, but I hadn't read any of her books before, but I liked the story, you know, since it had several layers to it.
Yeah, that's what held my interest because while I was reading it, I wasn't loving the writing style in this one because it felt really like always stating the obvious, so on the nose, like everything was just being spoon-fed. And I felt like, wow, I didn't notice this in her other books that I read. You know, like her other books, I felt like there was a bit more nuance to her writing. So this one just kind of felt like, And then the way the characters spoke was so formal. And I don't know if like in the past, because of course it's a dual narrative, one in 2007 and then the other one like 80 years before that in the 1920s. But it was just really formal, even when they're in bed together. They're speaking so formally. What's her name? Maya and what's her boyfriend's name? Fabiano or whatever.
Yeah.
They were, the dialogue just felt really stiff and stilted. And that's why I gave it a B minus, because while I was still interested in Isabella's story and Maya's story, and I think it's unique and being based on the Pleiades and all that, but I just couldn't get past the stiff dialogue sometimes.
Yeah, well, that's probably why I gave it a B rather than like a B plus or whatever, because I have to agree with you that the dialogue just didn't seem to flow as well in certain things. The story, you know, the premise and the story, the way it unfolded was good, but yeah, the dialogue, I think, should have been a little bit less formal. Maybe back in the earlier times, but not in the modern times for sure.
Yeah, those were, I think, my critiques. But other than that, I really am interested to continue the series. I think I'm going to, you know, continue and read the next book, Allie's Story, because I'm curious how it will all play out. And I have some suspicions. I suspect that Pa Salt may not be dead because it just seems weird that he didn't want anyone there and no one's actually seen him dead. And some people were talking about that in the group, that they also suspect that he's still alive. I think Dar was saying that.
Yeah, we'll have to see. But yeah, I'd like to continue with the next story too, just to see how things unfold and what the backstory is for Allie, as you said. So it's interesting. The author planned well to have all these different sisters, because that way I guess she could have made a pitch to the publishers and the editor and say, hey, you know, this would be a good
seven
idea.
Book series.
Yeah, and they said, yeah, okay.
Yeah. And then in each one, a different and interesting setting, because I think Allie's story takes us to Norway.
Oh, okay.
And this one was set, of course, in Brazil.
Right.
A different country for each sister where he adopted them from.
That'll be interesting then, because you always like to learn the background of those countries and a little bit, even if you just learn a little bit through some of the explanations or the descriptions of the country. It's always good to learn more.
Yeah, and I think I read that each one is based or set around some big event, you know, in the past in the country. So like this was set around the construction of Christ the Redeemer in Rio, And then in each country, she does something else.
Okay, well, that makes it extra interesting.
Yeah, I think so. Were you familiar with the Seven Sisters?
No.
The Pleiades? No?
No.
Me neither.
I don't know that one. I mean, I don't remember that much about it, except now they have some of these action movies with are connected to mythology and everything. Mm-hmm. I think mainly when I was younger, it was mainly like about Greek mythology. That was the big thing that you read bits and pieces about, and that, you know, they played up more. But even now, it seems like I said that some of these modern stories try to work in mythology and in its own way,
because, you know, those stories tend to be really interesting,
right?
Greek mythology and stuff. So yeah, it's like fertile ground to, you know, spin your own tale,
right? Or modernize it or whatever.
Exactly. Yeah. So did you find the construction interesting?
I did. Yeah. I mean, because I never knew what went on behind that. I guess you always just see this huge statue there, and you think, wow. But I never knew anything about what went into constructing it. And you knew it had to be, you know, some big deal, but mm-hmm. It was interesting how much went into it, and how it wasn't just somebody there in Rio, but they went a long distance to find somebody that could do the type of statue they envisioned.
They went to France, to Paris.
Right. So, yeah, I mean, that was pretty amazing, all they did to have it. And then, you know, it'll be something that hopefully will be there forever, practically.
Yeah, I've heard that it's been struck by lightning and they've repaired it.
Right, yeah.
I've seen it, but I was not familiar with anything to do with the construction either. I didn't even know when it had been constructed, like how old it was.
No, me neither.
Okay, so let's get into a bit about the story. So it's Maya's story, and she heads off to Brazil to learn about her birth family. And I think it's interesting that she learns all this stuff about her great-grandmother, Isabella.
Right.
And then her mother, her actual parents, it was like 2 pages.
Right. I was a little surprised by that.
So really, this felt like Isabella's book.
Right.
Not really Maya's book.
Maya being the descendant of this. Isabella.
Oh, this was another little thing that made me give it a minus. Isabella, even though I was interested enough to keep reading, I didn't find her that interesting. She just was a really young girl who had to get married, and she had expectations placed on her, and then she falls in love with this guy in France, and she wasn't that interesting. I would have liked to see her have a little more substance to her, I think.
Well, I think she was maybe more, she was just a typical woman of the time.
That, right.
You know, she came from money, and you were expected to, you know, not marry for love, but to marry for money or social status, especially from the way her father was. But, you know, you just couldn't necessarily fall in love with whoever you wanted to.
No. So that was her big dilemma. You know, right. she wanted to spread her wings and go off and live her life. But then, you know, she had to do what was expected of her.
Right. Because she loved her father so much, even though he was pushing her to live the life he wanted to. But she didn't want to disappoint him. That was a big thing for her, that she didn't feel like she could disappoint her father or her family.
Right. And I admired her in the end, even though she had this deep desire to live her own life and do what she wanted, she still made the decision to accept her lot. I will do what I have to do, which I right. thought was really mature of
right.
her.
She was still young.
Still yes. very young, because she died at 21,
right.
which I thought was so terrible. But yeah, she made these choices very consistently, even after she found out she was pregnant. You would think, oh, I'm pregnant and it's not my husband's. I've got to run off to Paris with
right.
Laurent. But no, she decides, no, that's not what would be best for my baby.
Right.
So yeah, I think her character was consistent in that way.
Yeah, she and Laurent were sort of like star-crossed lovers, so to speak. So
yeah. And you know, I didn't really, maybe it was because of the writing, like I was saying before, being a bit formal and stiff, it just felt distant to me, and I never felt any emotional heart to any of these romances. Really. So even her love with Laurent, it was like, okay, you know, they're in love, but I didn't feel it.
You wanted more passion.
I think so. Yeah. I wanted to feel this love and feel this tragedy that, you know, he had to go back off to France without her, but I didn't feel it.
Well, and, you know, it makes for a better story that they both, you know, gave up what they wanted. But because you think if she'd gone back to France with the baby and everything, then I don't think living in poverty would have been too good. And she might not have lived any longer, because if you live in a poverty stricken thing, you're not going to eat that well or live that well. And so it wouldn't have very been good for her or the baby.
Yeah, they both would have had to work and struggle. And she was aware of that. She wasn't so silly.
And eventually she might have regretted it, that she made that choice, you know.
Probably, even because they were both so young. You know, he was a few years older than her.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, we don't know that this would have lasted.
Right.
Because he was like her first love.
Right.
And then, of course, her husband, Gustavo.
Oh, my goodness.
He surprised me in the end.
Yeah.
And, you know, I couldn't help thinking that when he was encouraging her to go to France and, you know, enjoy herself before they get married, I was thinking, oh, I wonder if he's got a woman, you know, that he wants to spend some time with before he marries. Or is he gay? Or, you know, like, what is it? But it was nothing. Nothing. He was just being generous.
He was just being generous, you know.
But I kept thinking, oh, maybe he has some ulterior motive.
Yeah, I did too.
Like, he's going to fulfill his parents' wishes, but, and pretend, like, because I kept thinking he was being so nice to her before they married, and maybe it was an act of, you know, like, partially an act.
Yeah.
But no, he said he really loved her. So in the end, even after he discovered the truth about her and Laurent, he didn't tell her anything.
No.
And he just accepted Beatrice as his own.
Well, I said, I think probably he did it to thwart his mother, because his mother had had him under her thumb his whole life.
Yeah.
And sometimes you think that even though he loved Isabel, that maybe, you know, some of his bad treatment and being rough with Isabel was partly a way of being mad with his mother and taking it out on her too. I don't know. Maybe I'm being too psychological here. So, no. But I'm just saying, you couldn't blame him, because his mother, there was never a nice word that came out of that woman's mouth.
Yeah. And in that way, she seemed like a mustache twirler character to me.
Yeah. But I'm just saying, but there's mothers that they're kind of, what do you call it? They use smother love, you know, and even back then, she just wanted to run his life and she thought she was doing what was best for him. But, and there's people, thank goodness not too many of them, that they're just like bitter and they're just, you know, negative all the time.
Exactly.
So I'm just thinking, you know, that was part of the thing too, but that she had to go along with it just like her husband did, because even though they had this so-called pedigree, they didn't have the money anymore, you know. So like, I guess some of these people that had these fancy manners in Europe or England or whatever had these titles, but then the money ran out. You know, Gustavo marrying to that family was going to save their bacon. They were going to be able to not only have pedigree, but they'll have a way to come up in the world too, money-wise. And it did, because Isabel's father, you know, renovated their whole house for them and everything. Took, and they had, I guess it was like a dowry too, gave them a whole bunch of money. So they were doing okay.
And in the end, they gave some of it back to him after the stock market crashed and he lost everything in his coffee business.
Right.
Gustavo, you know, and his dad did the decent thing and helped.
Right. You know, it was so surprising, because that seemed like before that was the main thing they were after. But I guess they realized he'd saved their bacon before. So they were trying to help him out after all everything was said and done.
And I don't think they would have been in a position to help him if he hadn't have helped them.
Helped him,
if they hadn't married his daughter,
I would have been broke.
Exactly. Exactly. So, yeah, and back to Maya, her mom, I did feel when Beatrix was telling her about her daughter, Christina, and Maya's mother, I felt that disappointment.
Yeah.
They did their best with her, and she, even for Beatrix to think that maybe she inherited something from her grandmother, Gustavo's mother.
Yeah.
It's like, No, because you're not related to Gustavo.
No.
But she never knew that. She never knew that. Wow.
But still was good that Maya found out about her background, even though she would never know her mother. At least she would know where she came from originally and, you know, how things came to be.
I have a feeling her mother's probably still alive and maybe
just like Pa Salt.
Just like Pa Salt. Exactly. Yeah, because they didn't say she was dead.
No, but there was all those problems. I don't know if I'd want her back in my life after finding out these other things.
Yeah, but it's been 35 years.
That's so true. Things can change. Yeah,
we don't know what's become of her.
Right.
And the fact that Maya gave her baby up for adoption and now still wants to find him. I think we might hear through, you know, one of the other books in the series that Maya found her mother or something.
Could be. So, yeah.
Yeah. We'll see. And then, of course, her and Floriano, their relationship, I think the reason I didn't feel much is because they've known each other for 3 freaking weeks.
Right.
It's like, really? I mean, I know he's there helping her unearth her past and her heritage and everything, but 3 weeks?
Yeah.
And they were behaving as though they're ready to get married and spend the rest of their lives together.
That was a little quick, yeah.
Yeah, kind of quick. I thought it was a good start, and I'm interested to see how things unfold and maybe if the writing style kind of improves for me in the next book.
A little less stilted, right?
Yeah, less stilted and formal, because I was reading when Maya and Floriano are in bed together and they're still talking to each other in such formal ways. Like, who's talking to each other like that? So we'll see. But yeah, I liked it. It was an interesting story.
Yeah, you picked a good one.
Yes, I did. Speaking of one more thing before I forget, I mentioned in the group, I think that Pa Salt is the little boy that Belle rescued in Paris.
Yeah, I didn't even think about that till you mentioned it, but it makes sense. It kind of ties in nicely.
And the fact that he has one of the original mini Christ the Redeemer statues, what they call it, the Cristo, that
right.
Pa Salt had that in, that was signed by the designer guy, the sculptor that Laurent was working for. He had that in his study.
Yeah, well, where did that come from, if not, right?
And not only that, but there was something else that I felt connected him to that. There were those two things. And when he said to her, "I will never forget what you've done for me," or something like that, the little boy said to Belle.
Right.
And there was some other thing when he was in the workshop with the sculptor and Laurent, and I think there was something else mentioned there, and that led me to think, I think he's Pa Salt. And I think the age, he died in his 80s.
Yeah, that timeline would work out right, too.
If he's really dead. And if he's not really dead, then I think it's kind of cruel if he really faked his death or something. Cruel
so
to
he
the
could
girls.
Set them off on this journey. Right?
Yeah. I mean, would that be the only reason he did it? I mean, he's like this billionaire. I don't understand. And then the fact that the guy that Maya had been involved with, that she got pregnant for, his father's ship, Ali saw his ship near her dad's ship. I think Pa Salt may have intervened with the adoption of her baby. Yeah, because how did he find out about it? How does the lawyer know about it? When she went to see the lawyer in Switzerland, he knew that she had given up a son for adoption. How'd he know?
Yeah, I didn't think about that part, but you're right. Yeah.
And then he wrote in his letter to Maya that family is the most important thing, something that made her suspect he knew that she'd given a baby up. So I think he probably intervened. He seems to be, you know, the puppet master
in
their lives. So yeah, that's what I think. And the lawyer arranged the adoption, or maybe the baby is closer than she thinks.
Right.
He didn't go far. But yeah, so there are some little mysteries and suspicions I have that I'm eager to read the rest of the series to find out if I'm right.
That's right.
Yeah. So at some point I'll start the next book.
Me too.
So I was going to talk a little bit about the other books by Lucinda Riley that I liked a bit more. I really loved The Lavender Garden. I highly recommend The Lavender Garden by her. I really like that. I gave that one an A.
Ooh.
Which is, you know, rare for me. And then I read The Midnight Rose.
Oh, okay.
Midnight Rose. That one was very long. Like, I remember it being like a 500 or 600 page book or something, but pretty good. I enjoyed that one too.
Okay. Well, I'll have to look into those.
Yeah. And ever since I read The Lavender Garden, I started reading more and more of her books. And then I read another one I didn't like as much. I liked The Seven Sisters better than I liked that one. The Girl on the Cliff. I didn't love that one. And I think that one was set in Ireland, but I will continue to read her.
Yeah, it's always good books. To find, you know, new authors that you enjoy.
Yeah. So are there any scenes that stand out for you?
Well, I don't know. I think we've discussed most of them.
I think the thing that stands out to me when Beatrix was telling her about her mother and the troubles they had with her, that scene was probably one of the better scenes to me.
Oh, okay.
In the book, because I just felt so bad for Beatrix.
Oh, yeah.
And then when Gustavo cuts Lowen off when she was trying to deliver that letter to Laurent.
Oh, I forgot about that.
And she's forced to give him the letter. Oh my God. Yeah, I think I remember those the most.
Yeah.
So I'm glad that this was a good one. Everybody enjoyed it.
Right. It's nice to have different opinions, but it's still good to see a book that people enjoy and can still discuss in depth.
Yeah, exactly. I think there's one A. The majority of the grades were Bs, B+, one A and one C. I think Faith gave it a C.
Mm.
Faith and two Cs, Mary.
Okay.
And then someone gave it an A. Maybe it was Miriam.
I'm not sure.
But the majority, B+. I think I was the only B-. All right. So that is our discussion of The Seven Sisters by Lucinda Riley. We want to thank our listeners for tuning in. And please leave us your comments below. Let us know what you thought. Stay tuned for our next episode. We'll be discussing Verity by Colleen Hoover. Bye.
Bye.